Yeah, that's... Amy, shut up. All right, good morning. Let's get our last suites over there in the back. How we doing? Good? Conference good so far? Freedom good? How good was that bacon this morning? Tasted like freedom. I think Reagan would be proud of that bacon. I'm going to turn it over to my colleague Amy Lutz for a second for a special introduction.
Are you serious?
AV?
Can we play it?
Who are you?
I'm no one. Follow me.
Nothing will stand in our way. I'll show them the dark side.
I don't know your name.
Finn, what's yours?
I'm right.
He might need this.
I
I was going to ask who's excited for Star Wars, but I think that kind of answered my question. All right, so there's a reason why we played that. Partially because we wanted an excuse to play the trailer from Star Wars during AAF conference.
That's 100% the reason.
Emily's not very happy with it. But another reason is, you know, how long ago did we hear about this movie? 2 years? I mean, they've been marketing this for a year or two. And I think, in a sense, you can translate this to your campus. When you have an event on campus, when you're bringing in a speaker, you can't put posters up the week before and expect people to come to the speaker. You have to market it weeks in advance, just like they do for Star Wars. So, there you go.
Wow.
How to market your event, Star Wars.
Star Wars style.
So I hope you all have been enjoying the conference so far. We had a great banquet last night with Michelle Bachman. I think we can all agree on that. Yeah? Yeah? Let's clap. And the rest of our speakers have been simply fantastic. What we'd like to do now is that we'd like to have an activist panel here so that we can share our stories with you guys. All of us here on this stage have overcome adversity on our campuses because of we were conservatives. And we're almost 100% sure that you are maybe experiencing the same things. Our friends from Mizzou, if they're here yet, they're clearly going through some tough stuff down there. But the good thing that is that YAF is there for them. And we want you to know that YAF is there for all of you as well. So today, I'm going to introduce three of my colleagues who will share their stories on their campuses. First, we're going to have Amy Lutz, who's our program officer out here on the West Coast. Amy was graded very lowly in college because she used a Ronald Reagan quote. But Amy didn't let that deter her from her activism, probably made her more active, so she's going to tell you more about her story. Then we're going to have Emily Jashinsky, who's our program officer for public relations. She works at the headquarters out in Reston for us. Emily is, you've probably seen her on Fox News a couple times in the last few weeks. She's an expert with that earpiece that they put in you. She's on Varney & Co., and it went out the other day, but Emily played along real well. She watched the clips on foxnews.com.
Or don't.
Or do.
It's kind of embarrassing.
Emily was referred to as ISIS while she was on her campus at George Washington University.
Only partially true.
Partially true, okay. And she's going to tell you a little bit more about what happened at GW. Then we have Jolie Ballantyne, who's our conference director. Jolie was at Penn State, and she definitely played around with those free speech zones on campus. And she's going to tell you a lot about how to overcome this. I know a lot of you here are on campuses where free speech zones are prominent, and your administrations want to basically censor you or not allow you to be active by putting you on this little small patch of grasses. UCF, where are you at? Carter, hi. I was just at UCF recently, tabling with them on their free speech zone, which I can tell you is not even the size of this stage. But somehow, our activists there were able to get a big American flag tent up, and then they put a Berlin Wall on that. It's amazing the things you can do with a free speech zone. So we're going to tell you a little bit more about that, but now I'm going to call up my colleague Amy Lutz. Not call up, you're going to sit down. She's going to tell you about
patriarchy.
Her. Amy?
Typical right. Men.
Making the women sit down. All right, so I promise, on that note, I promise I will not talk about Star Wars the whole time, despite the fact that I would really like to. So what I'm going to do is I will tell you guys a little bit about my journey as an activist, things I experienced on campus, and some of the lessons that I learned that hopefully you guys can take back to your campus. We're going to all talk about our stories, but we definitely have question and answer sessions. So if you have any specific questions, if you are having trouble finding an advisor, if your campus is the University of Missouri and it is basically blowing up, if you have any specific questions, make sure to ask us those during Q&A. So, as Andres mentioned, I went to St. Louis University in St. Louis, Missouri. It is a Jesuit Catholic school. And do we have anybody who goes to a Catholic school here? Okay, so we have a few of you. For most of you who go to, Catholic schools have interesting issues. They talk a lot about social justice, and basically all your professors are communists. So it was a very interesting experience. So I started there. I graduated a couple years ago, and when I started out on campus, I knew I wanted to get involved with the conservative club on campus, and I did. I got involved. We did speaking events. We brought several speakers in through YAF, but I didn't really understand that my campus was not conservative until the first or second semester of my freshman year. I actually went to a Catholic school thinking that it would be conservative, and I found out quickly that I was very, very wrong. So again, as Andres mentioned, I took a theology class my first semester of college, during which a professor graded me down 12% on a paper because I used a quote from Ronald Reagan. And he did the same thing for a friend of mine. So that was very shocking to me. I didn't understand why that happened on college campuses. I didn't experience that in high school. And then later that same semester, we tried to bring in David Horowitz. And if you guys are familiar with David Horowitz, he talks a lot about radical Islam and the Middle East. So we tried to bring him in through Young America's Foundation on campus. And the school basically said no. You know, he's too controversial. We don't want, you know, the controversy at this school. And David Horowitz himself, you know, called up the administrators and said, all right, I will meet with, I will have a debate with a liberal professor if you want it to be balanced, quote unquote. And they still said no. I mean, we catered to all of their whims and the event was still canceled. So that was really when I realized, oh wait, you know, conservative thought is not really accepted on college campuses. So that's really when I became active. I think for a lot of people in this room, most of you go to pretty liberal schools. I mean, I know we have a couple from Liberty and a couple from maybe some more conservative schools, but most of you are going to experience something like this. And my thought on it is you're going to face difficulties as a conservative whether you are active or not. You can be quiet and not get active on campus, and you're still going to have problems. You're going to have professors who tell you that Ronald Reagan was a terrible president. You're going to have professors who teach you from Howard Zinn's The People's History of the United States, which happened to me, which he was a communist, by the way. You're going to face those issues regardless of whether you're active, and which I think is a better reason to be active on your campus, because you guys are the first line of defense against this kind of thing. Should I take your...
Yeah.
Sorry, Emily. You guys are the first line of defense against liberal indoctrination on campus. And in a sense, I feel like we all have a responsibility to stand up against that. Most campuses, like mine in St. Louis, bring in liberal speakers all the time and only bring in liberal speakers. We had a conference on campus my junior year that was basically... an anti-Israel conference. It was, they had people there who were from Hamas, and it was really ridiculous. We had Tim Wise, who used to be of CNN, who talked the entire time about how the Tea Party was racist. And we've had a number of, you know, very liberal speakers, like most of you have had at your school. But then we try to bring, God forbid, one conservative speaker my freshman year, and he's too controversial. So there's definitely a double standard on campus, and that's something that you all will experience. But I want to tell you a couple things, kind of takeaways, and I'll give you a couple examples from what I learned in college. First off, you know, one of the most beneficial things you can do is educate yourself on the school's speech codes. For example, if you are at a UC school, or if, I mean, UC schools are particularly bad with speech codes, but know where your free speech zones are, if there are free speech zones on campus. I'll give you an example. I know Missouri, the Supreme Court recently decided, the Supreme Court of Missouri, that free speech zones were, they outlawed them on college campuses, but there are a couple schools that have not updated their policy yet to eliminate free speech zones. So that's something very important for you to know. I mean, if you're in Missouri, for example, I guess I'm speaking mostly to them right now, you know, go to that free speech zone that's technically illegal and stage a free speech rally. You know, make sure you're bringing attention to that kind of thing. So know the rules of school. Know the school's policies, because one thing that school administrators like to do is find loopholes to prevent you from, you know, bringing a conservative speaker on campus or staging a conservative event. I'll give you an example. This actually happened the year after I graduated, but I was still like working with the conservative group on campus. They tried to bring in Scott Brown to speak. Now, this was before Scott Brown was running for Senate. He was not a candidate. He was just a former candidate for Senate, just a, you know, out speaking. I mean, people expected him to run for Senate, but he had not declared yet. So the group was supposed to bring him in, and the school said no. Because he might someday run for office, it is a violation of their 501c3 status at a private college. However, throughout my years in college, we had brought Senator Roy Blunt, for example, when I was in Missouri, and he was running for office during the time. We'd brought numerous people who had been running for office. The Democrats had Claire McCaskill on campus, who is a senator from Missouri, while she was running for office. It was complete opposite of everything that happened on campus. So they tried to find this loophole, you know, to prevent a conservative speaker from coming to campus. And long story short, we fought it. They eventually had the event off campus. But in that case, it's very important to know the rules, know know the 501c3 status of your school, how those rules work. So if they try to pull something like that, if administrators try to find a loophole to prevent you from doing something conservative on campus, you can speak to that. Secondly, something that's very important is to trust but verify, to use a Reagan quote. It's very easy. I had a friend in college who was in my, she was my vice chair when I was president of the conservative club. She used to say she was never sure whether we were being targeted for our conservatism or we were just victims of bureaucracy. You know, there's cases in college, I mean, you guys have all dealt with this. College bureaucracies are notoriously slow. You know, you might turn in an event form and they don't get back to you for 3 weeks. And that doesn't mean that they don't like you because they're conservative. It could be that. But it could also mean, you know, you're just, you know, they're just being slow. So you want to make sure you're choosing your battles correctly. Don't stage a protest on campus because they haven't approved your event in 7 days. You know, and I say that from experience. I used to get so frustrated when the administration was not doing what it wanted. So choose your battles wisely, but make sure to speak out when you feel like you're being targeted. One more thing I'll mention is a question that I've gotten before actually on an activism panel is why I went to a liberal school when I'm conservative. You know, we're going to all talk up here about our experiences about being at very liberal schools. And first off, I, you know, it was somewhat of an accident. I thought I was going to a conservative school. But at the end of the day, I would not change it for the world. I would almost rather be at a very liberal campus than being at a very conservative campus because you hone your skills in activism. You learn your arguments better, and it's very difficult to be inspired to activism at times when you're not being challenged. You know, there are very important battles that need to be fought on liberal college campuses. And again, to use Emily's phrase, you guys are the first line of defense against that. So don't be afraid about, you know, being on a liberal campus, you know, dealing with something like that. You know, at the end of the day, I made the best friends that I ever did in my conservative club because we were all bonded over the fact that everyone else on campus, you know, the vocal minority probably, but was liberal. You know, the professors were liberal, the students were liberal. And so we had such a strong club, and I think a lot of students will realize that as well. And one more thing I'll talk about is, you know, you want to make sure, it's very intimidating to be an activist, and it's okay to be scared. You know, I remember when I was a freshman in college, I had, you know, no idea what, you know, college was like. I was still kind of getting my bearings in college, and, you know, I decided that I wanted to speak out against, you know, school canceling our speaker and things happening, and it was very scary. You know, I thought, you know, what if other students don't like me? What if, you know, like that kind of thing. And I was called names and things like that. Those are things that Emily can, I'm sure, talk to as well. But it's okay to be scared. But at the end of the day, being active on campus is rewarding. It is worth it. And it is absolutely something that you need to follow through with. Because if you guys don't do it, then no one will. I mean, it is your responsibility, I feel like, to be an activist on campus. So don't worry about being scared. Don't worry about being intimidated. The Young America's Foundation is here for you all. If you ever face any issues on campus, I know we have been on the phone multiple times with a lot of campuses this week because everything is basically going crazy. So we are here to help you out. You know, if I have not experienced it, if none of us have experienced an issue on campus that you're facing, we have worked with someone who has. So don't feel like, you know, you're too afraid to approach us. We would definitely be more than happy to talk to you about any issues you're having on campus. I'm probably rambling here, so I'll cut off, but I look forward to talking to you guys during Q&A.
Thank you, Amy. And now ISIS herself, Emily Jashinsky.
That's rude. So I want to start off by saying there was no dress code for this panel. I think Jolie just didn't get the memo.
Or me.
I didn't get the best memo.
What I want to talk about is sort of what Amy brought up.
Sorry.
But I think our speakers really have done an incredible job, and they always do. We have, you know, such powerful speakers. They do an incredible job of bolstering your beliefs on conservative policy, your knowledge. I can't even try to compete with them, but there is one thing that I am an expert on. I just kind of stumbled into becoming an expert at it, and you guys all can do the same thing, and that is campus activism. if you don't feel like you're an expert in campus activism, you can become an expert in campus activism. I would say that just about a year ago, I probably never would have considered myself an activist. And I had been active in my chapter at George Washington University for 3 years. I was just a year ago, I was a college senior. I graduated in May. And I was the chair of our YAF chapter at GW, and I probably wouldn't have considered myself an activist. I didn't think I did enough. And I think that speaks to something important. We sort of look at our government leaders, we look at the policy experts at think tanks and the media talking heads, we look at them as the people with real impact. And really, I think that's the most dangerous misconception that you're taught in college. That's sort of what I think is the most important thing we can impress upon you, is that that's completely wrong. It's actually the opposite. You're the people with real power. So what we like to help you do in Young America's Foundation is, this past week, you've seen this explosion on campuses of controversy. And so it started at Mizzou, and then, you know, it sort of happened all across the country after that. Like, this was, we're seeing a ripple effect. And they're all feeding off of the energy. The left is feeding off of the energy that we saw at Mizzou. And now we have the Million Student March and everything. And man, what a time to be a campus activist. Really, you couldn't have picked a better time. So what we like to help you do with the foundation is, so we have this sort of, you know, I don't want to call it a battle plan, but it's really what it is. There's this really tried and true template of success that you can follow and that I followed as a student, is you have this eruption of controversy, then we'll help you bring in a speaker, we'll give you the support, and then there's change. So what happened to me at George Washington University was, if you ever want a great story, a heartwarming story, talk to the George Washington University students here about it. I'm going to get into it a little bit right now. Oh, man. I was asked by our student newspaper to provide comment on a story about something that our student association had just passed, a bill that our student association had just passed, which would mandate sensitivity training for students in leadership on student organizations about LGBT issues. And they asked me if I would be interested in seeking a religious exemption on behalf of YAF. And I was like, yeah, that sounds like a great idea. Because if you looked into what they were teaching at the sensitivity training, it was, you know, you must refer, and when I say must, I mean must. The sensitivity training was saying you must refer to people by Z and Zer and Per and whatever those words are. I shouldn't even say words, that's an overstatement. And I said, yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's completely not something that we would want to be a part of. It seemed like it was fine. It didn't seem like that was insane. But a few days later, the story came out, and you know, I'd felt pretty good because nothing had happened in a few days, and I hadn't been called the litany of names that they like to use. It was a snow day, and I was in my bed watching Netflix. It was chill. that always gets a laugh. All of a sudden, I had Twitter open in one tab, Netflix in one tab, and Twitter in another, obviously, because I'm a millennial. And all of a sudden, I started getting a bunch of tweets. I'm like, what's going on? People were calling me ISIS. People were calling me, the names that I got, I can't even repeat. Yeah, ISIS was probably the most dramatic of them all. I'm not sure what I did to deserve that title. But the LGBT organization on the GW campus came out and said that we had committed an act of violence by refusing to use transgender pronouns. Committed an act of violence. Meanwhile, the actual ISIS members are throwing LGBT people off of bridges and burning them alive. And the YAF chapter at GW is violent. It makes no sense. But so we were being just absolutely, you know, bombarded with these things and everything. You know, it was really tough. I skipped class for 2 weeks. I was only in one class, and it was advanced poetry writing, which if you know how much GW costs, is not a good way to spend your money, as it turns out. And there aren't a lot of conservatives in advanced poetry writing, which you might be surprised to find out. Anyway, so I skipped my poetry class for 2 weeks, which was tough. And it was the amount of hate that we were getting. It was actually, in all seriousness, was really tough to deal with. This is not going to sound tough, but I was on spring break in Punta Cana. I was trying to relax. And my phone was blowing up the whole time, you know, with tweets calling me hateful. And they were coming from all over the country because this was in the national media. It was all over, you know, the conservative outlets, and it was all over Fox. And so it was coming from everybody. It wasn't just coming from students at our school. And in all seriousness, it was very difficult. And it will be very difficult for all of you if you make the simple decision to express what you believe in, which pretty much 80% of the country would be behind you on that. There's nothing exceptionally controversial about saying you don't want to go to training that forces you to call a man Zer. You know, that's not really asking too much. But what happened was Young America's Foundation helped me bring in Senator Rick Santorum to speak. And Senator Santorum came in, and the left was so excited for this. It was like Christmas for them. They were like, oh, we're going to get him. You know, we're going to show Senator Rick Santorum what's up. And so they showed up in big numbers. They, you know, you could tell during the speech that they were just fuming. And then came time for the Q&A, and this girl marches up to the microphone. She's so excited, you can see it. She's just like bubbling with excitement. And she starts off, Senator Santorum. I am a proud lesbian woman. Why should I not have the right to marry who I want to marry? She wanted to drop the microphone. She thought she had him. Like, nobody had ever asked Rick Santorum such a tough question. You could see it in her face. And so he engaged with her. I mean, they were going in back and forth about what religious liberty means. What is the concept of religious freedom? And he kept challenging her and challenging her. And finally, he brought up a point. He turned it on its head, turned her argument on his head, on her head. What, I don't know what I'm saying. Said something to her. Entire room went quiet. He said, you know, would you, and this really shows how, you know, infrequently the left's arguments are challenged on campus. It was a pretty obvious point. He said, you know, would you force, you know, someone at an Orthodox Jewish bakery to bake something that they don't believe in? Again, the room got really quiet. You could see the look on her face. She just went, never thought of it that way before. That was the best moment of my activism career at GW. Because you could see on their faces that they had learned something and that they had had to reconsider their entire belief system. I guarantee you some of them walked out of that room with a different understanding of religious liberty. And this was the far left. You can make a difference on your campus. It's really not that difficult. And all you have to do is be honest about what you believe in. President Reagan said all great change happens at the kitchen table. Right now in America, college campuses are the kitchen table. They're where Americans permanently forge their set of beliefs. You know this, you're in college right now. This is where you're forming your beliefs and values that you're going to base the rest of your life on. It's on your college campus. So don't take your influence lightly. You're not just in college. You say that a lot, right? Well, you know, I'm just in college. You're not just in college. It's an incredible job. It's a job. You have so much responsibility. You have so much power. Young Americans for Freedom was founded in 1960, September 11, 1960, in Sharon, Connecticut, at the home of William F. Buckley. They wrote and drafted something called the Sharon Statement. I don't know if any of you have heard it. If you haven't, you need to read it right now. It's the founding document of Young Americans for Freedom. It's what really ushered in the eras of, you know, Barry Goldwater and Ronald Reagan, gave us modern conservatism. it's an incredible piece of writing. And we just celebrated it. We just celebrated the anniversary of that, obviously the 55th anniversary of that, this past September with a seminar. 55 years for this piece of writing that was drafted in 1960. Everybody in that room, the oldest person was 28 years old. Majority of them were your age. And 55 years later, after the Reagan administration, after the era of moderate conservatism, we're still celebrating something that people your age drafted on a day in 1960. You have so much power. You're not just in college. You're on the front lines. You are where the real change happens. And with that, I will cede my time.
Thank you, Emily. And now I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Jolie Ballantyne, who was also known at one point as a Bible-thumping skinhead.
Just let that sink in for a moment. First of all, I'm going to apologize. I'm really trying to rally my voice. I have no idea what happened. So I'm just going to keep it really short for you. Yeah, because I really can't talk that much anyway. I'm going to tell you what happened to me when I was at Penn State, because that's really what got... I'm sorry, this is kind of funny even to me. Okay, so we brought our Yak chapter brought in Kate Obenchain on the Firing Up Freedom Tour to fire up freedom on campus, and it was really exciting, great event. And the next day, we went out to promote the Constitution, because it was Constitution Day, simply passing out the Constitution, but also drawing attention. I see some of your faces. You're just like, so you feel so bad for me. Just drawing attention to the egregious free speech policy at Penn State, or the lack of free speech at Penn State. Penn State is 8,556 acres, and less than 0.005% of the campus is open to free speech. So that's 12 free speech zones, which 12 sounds really nice. But when you do the math with Google Maps, it actually worked out. It's 0.003% of the campus that is open to the First Amendment. Let that sink in for a moment. That is ridiculous. The United States is a free speech zone. So the fact that our publicly funded university, our taxpayer funded university, does not allow student groups to exercise their First Amendment rights is absurd. So, of course, with our YAF chapter, we're not just going to let that slide. So we print out these huge posters and get them laminated and framed, and we have them up next to our table that says, "Free speech banned at Penn State, 8,556 acres, 12 free speech zones." And so we're passing out the Constitution. We have this table set up. We have constitutions. Like, we had 600 constitutions to pass out. So obviously, we're not just going to be holding them. And we have the sign set up, and we're in a free speech zone. And this man comes up, and I, honest to God, thought he was joking. He's like, "You can't be here." And I was like, "Ha, you're funny. Like, ha, free speech banned, you're trying to kick us out. Have a nice day." And he's like, "No, you can't be here." And of course, so with our YAF training, we knew, let's get this on camera. So the YAF team members had still been there from the night before. So one of them pulls out an iPad, and the guy's like, "This isn't going to help your cause, putting this on camera." And like, starts waving his hand and walks away. That's it. I was like, cool. Our one heckler for the day, we're just going to keep passing out the Constitution. It's all good. But then he comes back up. He brings out Judy Albine, which I'm sure she has a Twitter, so follow her and make sure to give her hell. And Miss Judy Albine comes out and starts trying to read us the riot act about why we can't be in the free speech zone. Because apparently at Penn State, there's different levels of free speech in the free speech zones. So in this free speech zone, a table is not allowed, which is not true, because there's regulations on how to manage your table in the free speech zone, which we are following all of them, of course. Like good conservatives, we like to follow the rules. And so we had a person at the table at all times. Our name was clearly displayed. We had our table. And not to mention the fact that we were off to the side by where all the smokers have to go, which is how I lost my voice, obviously. So we weren't blocking any walkways. We were not causing a fire hazard. We were following all the rules just to be good civic, people. We're just trying to pass out the Constitution, promote conservative values, and God forbid we do that at Penn State. So Judy Albine comes out and starts telling us, "You can't be here. You need to take your table down. You can stay and hold your 600 constitutions, but you can't have your table set up here." And of course, we're like, "No, that's not true." Like, that, we read the policy. We're allowed to be here. And essentially, she brought out another administrator from academic affairs threatening us to, that we'd be expelled. They're going to bring out the university police if we do not take our table down right away. And like David Hacker stole my speech, by the way, yesterday. So we always say, don't get arrested. That's important, especially if those of you interested in going to law school, which you shouldn't do. Don't get arrested. So we decided to take down our table, and they offered to let me come inside and discuss the policy with them. And you can see this is all, we got all of this on camera. So I volunteered to go in and discuss the policy with them because I read it and I knew what it was about, while another member took down the table. And as I walk inside with Judy and Alex, they run from me, like actually physically run from me. And this was a very large woman, and she ran. And I'm like, let's just be real, I'm not running after her. So I was in shock. I'm like, these people are running from me. That's the power that you have as students, by the way. Like, they're running from you because they're scared, because they know that they have nothing to stand on. They can't even stand on the policy because they know it's unconstitutional. So they run from me, they hide in this office, and of course I follow them like, you know, a minute behind, whatever. And I get to the office, I'm like, may I please speak with Judy Albine? And the lady at the front desk was like, she's not in here. I was like, I just saw her walk in here. She's not in here. And then I see like them peek around the corner. I was like, I can see them right there. Like, it's like, I'm supposed to have a meeting with them. We're supposed to discuss policy. Like, you have to make an appointment. They're not in here. I was like, they're really right there. And she just was not having it. There, by the way, there's no stairwell in that corner that they went to. Like, there was nowhere to escape from me. They were there and they just wouldn't talk to me. So what did we do? Of course, the first thing we did, we contacted YAF because luckily they were there when it happened. And we broke the story on Breitbart. But I also want to bring up the attention that this was an instance where I, as an activist, failed. If you go to Penn State today, they still have 12 free speech zones. And I graduated. I lost my opportunity to fight for free speech at Penn State because I lost standing. That's something that David Hacker might have mentioned yesterday, is that, you know, if you're going to fight on your campus, you have to be a student at that campus. You can't just... to sue your university as a student, you need to be a student. So this was an instance, like, don't be afraid to fail, because we still drew attention to the issue. I'm so passionate about the First Amendment now because of that experience. It caused a chilling effect for us for the rest of the school year. Like, we were unable to go out to table for any of our events now because we don't know which tables are allowed. And, you know, if you're threatened with the police once, are you going to get threatened with them again? Are you not even going to get a warning the next time? They're just going to come right out. So it was really important that me being in law school, I didn't get any legal issues. But this was an instance where, you know, I personally was not successful as an activist. I don't think that it's the end. I know we have students from Penn State here. It's not the end. Like, we can still fight for this. Free speech is worth fighting for. And I'm just going to wrap up with just a couple of quick things I think you guys should know, is that you should stand up for what's right, even if you're standing alone. Our YAF chapter was a disagreement about whether or not our free speech rights were violated. And so at the end of the day, it was really me and me alone with maybe a couple other members that were willing to stand up. I know our whole exec board was not in agreement on whether or not we should fight, whether or not we should sue the university, which is one of the things that took us some time, which I ended up having me lose standing in the case. And then don't worry about the names that they're going to call you. Like we've all alluded to, we've been called a lot of names. I mean, I know those of you at Mizzou who joined us a little late will, yeah, I got you there. you can attest to the fact that you are going to be called names. My personal favorite, as Andre said, was I'm a Bible-thumping skinhead. That was a professor who called me that, by the way. If that's all you got, like, come at me. Like, you calling me racist... Like, really? Really? How's that working for you? At Penn State, after this incident, we were compared, we were on the list of like 10 a-holes at Penn State, and we were second only to the person who threatened to shoot up our student union building. That's incredible. Fighting for free speech just passing out the Constitution in a free speech zone puts you up at the level of someone who's threatening to commit an act of terror. I mean, that's incredible, and it's scary that that's what's going on our campuses. And then lastly, just know that you're never alone. we talk about this all the time, but we have a YAF family, and we really are. Like, I made my best friends through Young America's Foundation and Young Americans for Freedom, and we also, the YAF staff, I think that we're always here for you. I know at Central Washington University, they had some free speech issues come up, and the first thing that they did, like, I got text messages and Facebook messages from the e-board, like, this is what's going on, this is what's happening, and we're there for you. Just as friends, and also to support you, the foundation is there. If you have a free speech issue on your campus, we will rush you the free speech box, mm-hmm. give you, like Emily said, a battle plan on how to handle these issues. We'll be there to support you, not only like with your quote unquote mental health, because it is stressful to be called ISIS. It is stressful to be called a Bible thumping skinhead. And when it happens to you for the first time, it can be traumatic and it can be scary. It's not nice. Like, we're nice people. We don't like to have our feelings hurt. But instead of holding up class and doing everything that they do at Mizzou, like, we actually let's fight back in a more practical way. So call YAF. We joke that the Freedom Hotline is available for you. So 1-800-USA-1776. We're there. And with that, I look forward to trying my best to answer your questions.
Thank you, Julie. And just to recap here really quickly, I mean, you guys cannot stand on the sidelines. There will be people on your campus that will tell you, why do you want to stir the pot? You better go stir that pot. I mean, the left has basically hijacked our universities.
It's like aggressive Rachel Ray or something. Yeah.
Touche. The left has basically hijacked our university system, and if your $250,000 that your education costs have gone down the drain, at least know that you stood up for freedom. Be happy with the fact that you stood up for freedom on your campus. Ronald Reagan said, freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. Our generation cannot be the one that surrenders it. So we need all you warriors, the real warriors, not the social justice warriors, to be out there on campus, to be fighting for free speech, for freedom, and to gain back our education system, because it is completely hijacked by the left right now.
Thank
Always
you, Rachel.
Call us. What?
Thank you, Rachel.
Rachel Ray up here. Woo. And never be, turned down by the fact that your campus is too small. No campus is too small to expose what the left is doing on these campuses. Send us your tips. We will put them out on the media. Emily does quite a good job at doing that. We will expose your story. We will get you attention. We will get justice on your campus. So call the Freedom Hotline, 800-USA-1776, and we'd be happy to take your questions now.
Pat is walking around with a microphone.
Behind your
back. Caleb.
Hi, my name is Caleb, and I go to Liberty University, and that being said, obviously Liberty is a very conservative school, and hearing your stories and seeing and hearing all your stories, it definitely makes me feel very fortunate to be attending Liberty. However, I think our issue is just, since we're so comfortable in this living in this conservative bubble, that we have taken for granted really everything that we're going through, because we're not having free speech issues, we're not being called ISIS or bigots and whatnot. But I think just like people at Liberty just don't know what's going on. They don't know what's going on in the real world. And they also don't know how to defend their views, almost, it seems, just because we're taken for granted of being at a Christian conservative campus, and we as a university cherish our the Bill of Rights, and we cherish the pro-life movement, we cherish veterans and whatnot. But I mean, with that being said, what is it that you think that individuals such as myself or anyone else in here who goes to a really strict conservative school that doesn't have these issues, what do you think that we can do to help ignite the fire for patriotism and stuff like that?
I think you're really fighting back against apathy on your campus. From what I heard, you guys are like, your Christmas tree lighting got more attention than Alan West, because they had it right across the street, like when you guys brought Alan West to speak. And from what I hear, like, I talked to Katrina a lot about this. She says, you guys have to appeal to your students, like, on a Christian level. Like, you're at the world's largest Christian university. Like, they have a duty, like, to promote their values. They have a duty to stand up for this country because Christians are in trouble across the world. And I think that that's a great way to appeal to them. I definitely think that you need to fight the apathy. It's so important that students get involved. And I think that you guys are in a unique position to be able to fight that.
Yeah, go ahead.
Let me go.
Yeah.
I just contagious. I'm losing my voice too. I just want to add. There it goes. One more thing to that, which is slightly tangential, is I think you guys understand this, but don't take for granted the fact that you go to a conservative school. I think, and I'll give you an example. Westmont College, just down the road, is a Christian college for years and years. It was, you know, the small conservative college. You know, they had a lot of conservative donors, and people valued it as being a school, you know, smaller version of Liberty. But in the last decade or so, I don't know how long it's been, it's become very liberal because people were apathetic, didn't realize that the student body was changing. There were administrators there who have caused a lot of problems. And now, today, you know, it's not really a conservative school anymore. It's more liberal. You know, we tried to, controversy follows him wherever he goes, but we brought in David Horowitz to our YAF chapter at Westmont College last spring. And I went, there was a good turnout, but the administrators and campus security said, well, you can't take pictures. You can't take pictures, because they wanted to basically erase the fact that he was there. They didn't want people to see that they had brought a conservative speaker. So I think my point on that is, don't take it for granted. Follow with Jolie said, and make sure you are inspiring people not to be apathetic, because you don't want to lose your campus.
Next question.
Yeah. While we wait for the next question, I'd also say I saw the video of Bernie Sanders at Liberty, and when they asked the pro-life question, I definitely saw, like, there were some people, when Bernie Sanders started to talk, like, there were some people going crazy excited that he was talking about the idea of pro-abortion, and that's something, like, that's an issue that, I mean, while your overwhelming majority of your people on your campus might be pro-life, there are still people out there who are definitely not. And I mean, so there's another issue that you can fight. There's always some liberals on your campus. So definitely go out there and kick the bear in the face.
Question. Right here.
So I go to UCI, the flag banning school. And last quarter, I took African American Studies because you had to take some studies.
I love, like, that class.
Yeah, it was a fun one. So
I had to drop it.
Yeah, well, luckily I'm done with it. But on day one, one of the girls who voted to ban the American flag was in my class, and the professor, who is a self-avowed lesbian Marxist, brought her up to the front of the room.
The best kind of Marxist.
Yeah, seriously. Brought her up to the front of the room and hugged her in front of everyone and thanked her for standing up to colonialism and oppression.
Oh,
yeah.
Brave.
So what I basically, God. I had to spend 10 weeks pretending to be a liberal.
No.
Yep.
No,
I still got a B minus, but I had to pretend to be a liberal. Yeah, I didn't see that one coming. But what I'm wondering is, in our classes, if we have those hyper-liberal professors that are really just off-the-wall crazy, like seriously crazy, how do we express our point of view, not even to just change their hearts and minds, but just to not have to pretend to be a Democrat for 10 weeks, because I don't know how to do it without, you know, negatively affecting your grade.
Yeah, I think Julie and I both have different opinions on this, and we'll give you both of ours and try to maybe, like, bridge the gap a little bit between both of our opinions on this. So on that, I actually had a really similar experience. I don't know whether or not she identified as a Marxist, but she certainly identified as a lesbian, was a professor, and was, like, very militant, very, very militant. And the first day of class said, you know, basically asked us, no, she didn't ask. She told us that race was a social construct. And from that point, I mean, she explained it with critical theory. Have you guys encountered critical theory in your classes yet? Yeah, you're nodding. Yeah, absolutely. And so she explained, you know, why race was a social construct. And for the rest of the semester, the entire class was premised on that belief. So if you did not buy into the core, the fundamental, foundational concept of the class, you would not even be able to participate in the rest of the semester. And that, to me, is the most dangerous type of liberal bias, because the entire class was premised on a concept that I think most of America would not agree with. So I went through that class, you know, playing the game, because if I didn't play the game, there was actually no way to participate in the class. So unless you want to, you know, stage this coup, one of our speakers, Larry Schweikert, he was a professor and a best-selling author. If you ever get a chance to hear him, it's an awesome opportunity. He says, you know, everything is not the biggest battle. You know, not every single assignment, every single class, you don't have to be, you know, the hero that's standing up for their beliefs, and, you know, that's just not always practical. So sometimes you do have to compromise. Other times, absolutely not, don't do it. But I think in those cases where it's a long-term thing, sometimes you have to play the game and fight bias on a larger scale. So while you might not be able to fight it in that particular class, go out and change your campus in other ways and chip away, slowly chip away, so that at a different time, you know, maybe for the kids that come after you, it's not like that. But no, I think that's definitely the hardest thing, Julie.
Yeah, of course, I disagree with it. To some extent, I think that, yes, not every assignment is the biggest battle in the world, but I believe that you should stand up for what you believe in. But I also say, before you start arguing with the professor, make sure you're on point. Don't say that you failed your paper because you're a conservative. You might have failed your paper because you suck at writing. So I'm just putting that out there. I had an experience, African-American studies. The professor started out the class saying that Lincoln was okay because he freed the slaves, but he was still racist because he was a Republican. I mean, that was how the class started. And my jaw dropped. And I was like, oh, God help me through this. So the first test came, and I mean, it's not anonymous grading, and I got a C on it. I'm an A student. I got a C on this test, and I was shocked. So by the way, it's multiple choice. So I took the test to the professor, and I showed him in the book where every answer I chose was right. And not to be like, oh, I'm so smart, but I was like, I don't understand how I got a C on this because every answer I chose was right. And he's like, he could not. He was like, no, but this one's better. But it wasn't. I mean, I literally could find quotes in the book that were the quote from the book was the answer, and it made no sense to me. And it was just because he didn't like me. There are people whose grades did not match mine, like whose answers match mine. They got it right, and it was just because I was outspokenly conservative and happened to be black in his class. He was not okay with that. He even said that it was okay for black students to use the N-word, but it wasn't okay for white students to use it in class. It was so ridiculous. So I took it to the associate dean of the department, and then I took it to the dean of the school. And that once I found out that those professors and those deans were willing to do nothing, then I dropped the class because it was my last semester and I couldn't afford to fail the class. So that I did choose my battles and took an English class or humanities class instead, which was equally awful. But at least the professor is fair. And I firmly believe that professors are willing to respect for the most part, I think are willing to respect opinions that are different from them if you can articulately state them. So, I mean, I'm always for standing up for your beliefs, and I always say I start my papers off with a quote from a liberal to, you know, give the professor a sense of security before I destroy their arguments.
Well, if I can bridge the gap between those two really quickly, I think, and it might be restating kind of what they both said, but you do want to make a judgment call based upon the class and based upon the context. I know Ben Shapiro has talked about this before when he took some classes. He'd say in class he'd be the biggest outspoken conservative, but it was anonymous grading, so he'd write like a communist and would you know, do well in the class. You know, I also had a lesbian Marxist professor my freshman year. That seems to be kind of a
so many
trend here, apparently. That's weird. Yeah, I mean, there are a lot of crazy ones like that. And I had this professor my freshman year who I was taking this class, and this is why I say make a judgment call. This was a class I was forced to take because I was in the honors department, but it was a sociology class. I was not a sociology major. This did not matter to my long-term, you know, goals. I was a history major. And so towards the end of the semester, we had this discussion in class about the Westboro Baptist Church. Now, everyone is all familiar with who the Westboro Baptist Church is. Okay. Well, I'm from Kansas. So I grew up about 45 minutes from where the Westboro Baptist Church is stationed, and they would, you know, do all their picketing and things like that. So this professor, this lesbian Marxist professor, was talking in class, and she was making the argument that there was no difference between the Westboro Baptist Church and Christians because we were both against gay marriage. And so I kind of raised my hand, and I was like, wait a second here. I'm like, I grew up in Kansas. I went to, you know, a Catholic school, and every time we went to Topeka, where they're stationed, our teachers would warn us, and they'd say, do not listen to these people. We do not believe in what they say. And they, you know, were obviously disagreed with what Westboro Baptist Church said. And this professor looked at me, and she said, well, isn't it funny how it works like that? Which I don't even know what that means. But and then just moved on, like completely ignored my question. And in that class, I ended up getting a B minus. The only two, you know, conservatives in the class got a B minus. So, I mean, you have to make a judgment call. In that case, that class did not really matter to my major, so I was a little bit more outspoken. If you're in a class, you know, if it's a thesis class, if it's a class that, you know, core class for your major, and you feel like you can't speak up, then, like Emily said, supplement it with other activism. You know,
C's get degrees.
Yeah, there we go. Go out and challenge it on the campus.
Last question.
Hi, my name is Marlena, and I attend Rutgers Business School in New Jersey, so I needn't say more about how liberal our campus is. We just learned this year that the Muslim Student Association on campus gets over $40,000 in funding, while our YAF and CR Club gets like $2,000 a semester. How do we go about this with the administration without it turning into a race issue or being called bigots by almost the entire student body?
Quick question. Do you guys apply for funding?
Yes.
So they apply for $40,000 and you apply for how much?
Donald.
What?
So it's like they actually have like eight different groups, so combined the eight groups like get that much. CR group we got like about $4,000 or $5,000. But we always ask for more and they cut us down and they don't cut them.
They don't cut them down. Okay, yeah. That's what I wanted to know.
Yeah, it's like we get our funding like half these other groups all.
Yeah, so what I would say to that is that's kind of something that's right in our wheelhouse as professionals at Young America's Foundation to help you deal with, because if you have evidence of that, we can change it by, you know, deploying the conservative media, national media. If you can provide us with evidence, we will do everything we can to help get your story out. And once you get your story out, guess who hears about it? Alum, board members, you know, sympathetic donors at the school. So it's a really powerful thing to be able to broadcast it. And I think, you know, you guys all saw the video, the Cavuto clip, right, of the Million Student March girl. You know, there is nothing better than that clip going viral, because what it's doing is taking your battles on college campuses to a wider audience, right? Because people don't know what it's like on college campuses. You guys do. And what that showed, it was just a textbook case of talking to a campus liberal. I mean, there honestly couldn't have been a better case study. And what happens when the left is, you know, they go through 4 years without having their beliefs challenged on a campus, and they're unable to string together a coherent sentence in defense of their core belief. So that's bringing it to a wider audience. And that's what you want to do. So that sounds like a pretty good example, right? So you have these equivalent groups, you know, doing a good job applying for funding, and one is getting gypped while the other is not. So if it's something like that, send it to us, and we'll do everything we can to tell your story and to get it out to the people who need to know.
I'd also add that, like Michelle Bachmann said last night, there's nothing racist about facts. Those are the facts that you guys are being discriminated against, or there's something fishy going on. Let the people draw their own conclusion that these Muslim-associated groups don't get their funding cut, but the one conservative club on campus does every single time. And if you can show that you guys are equally active or more active than they are and you deserve that funding, then there's no reason why, you know, the funding has to be content neutral. So.
And I'll just add one more thing to that. I mean, I agree 100% with both Emily and Julie. I think Emily's exactly right. If that happens, you know, come to us. That is definitely in our wheelhouse. But also, I want to wrap up with saying, you know, don't back down. I mean, that happened to me when I was in college. The university tried to cut the funding of my conservative group because they said we didn't fill out paperwork right or something. And we went in and proved that we had done it right. But what I did was, I mean, I walked into the student fundraise, you know, student funding committee or whatever they were called. There were like eight of them in the room. I walked in by myself, sat down and said, this is wrong. We need to change this. And they saw that I was not going to back down. I was going to call YAF. I was going to make a big deal about it if they did not give us our funding. And I sat in that room and I argued with them for about 45 minutes. And at the end of the day, I got an email the next week that they had, you know, given us the funding that we needed. So you know, let us know first with a specific example like that, but also don't back down. I mean, you have to tell the truth even if your voice shakes. I mean, you might be terrified to do
or
that.
Even if your voice is gone.
Well, like Jolie, you know, take Jolie's example, exactly. You know, like, don't back down, even if you're scared, even if you're not sure what to do. You know, obviously come to us with any issue like that, and if you have any other questions.
Thanks, everyone.
And no, further to your question, sorry, just one thing about it becoming a race issue. It's going to become a race issue because the left has no other strategy than to turn it into a race issue. Look at Mizzou, for example. Everything there is a race issue now. So don't back down on that, because just be armed with the facts, and it's okay to ask questions, and it's okay to present facts. When the left turns it into a race issue, let them kind of implode in their race issue, and you just stick to the truth. Thank you guys for listening to us this morning. If you have any questions, we're going to be around all day and at the ranch. And again, if you have anything that you'd like to send to us, 800-USA-1776. Call us for freedom. Thank you.
Thanks, Rachel.